Thank God that the Word is alive and it always accomplishes what God sets it out to do. Amen? Well, that leads me to say this, Clyde. You gave me a great segue. Easter has come once again, but not everybody's smiling. Not everybody experiences the joy that we experience. I think it's called the paradox of Easter. I mean, Easter is the holiest day on the Christian calendar, but not everybody shares our joy. Not everybody shares our excitement. In fact, some people just don't care. Others don't believe, and still others don't know what to believe. And some are even angry at the thought of a man rising from the dead because it actually challenges everything they think they know about this world. It challenges them. Easter reminds us in the biggest way possible that God plays by his own rules. Amen? I like that about God. It reminds us that he's God and we're not. Easter forces us to recognize that God doesn't always do what we expect, and sometimes he does what we least expect, and often he does things in a way that defy human understanding. Raising the dead definitely falls into that category. I'm going to just place a bet this morning that no one in this group has ever seen anyone rise from the dead. I know I haven't. And by the way, I worked at a funeral home for over a year during my college days and was involved in the entire process of the embalming. And I can tell you that I heard all kinds of stories, and people tried to scare me, and they said, you know, don't be afraid if during the embalming process that the corpse just sits up on that table. They said, it's just nerves. Don't be afraid. I thought, just nerves. I thought, Lord, if that ever happens, I'm going to make a whole new exit in that building. It never happened. The whole thought of a dead person coming back to life, I'm going to say it, it's a little spooky, it's a little weird, and quite frankly, it's scary. Well, that's how the disciples may have felt early on Sunday morning when they found the stone rolled away and the tomb was completely empty. I mean, I think they had to be just a little bit weirded out. It was all too strange for them. They did not immediately think Jesus is risen from the dead. In fact, they assumed the opposite. They really thought someone had come during the night and stolen his body. Remember what Mary said when she saw the empty tomb? The Bible says she wept and she told the angels, they've taken my Lord and I don't know where they've laid him. I don't know where they've put him. Resurrection was the last thing on her mind that first Easter morning. But eventually they all believed. It didn't happen suddenly. For some it took days, perhaps weeks, but soon, and I mean soon, the truth finally hit home. He's alive. First they whispered the truth behind closed doors. He's alive. And then they began to preach it in the streets. He's alive. And then they preached it to the very heart of the Roman Empire. He's alive. I remember years ago reading the story of one old-time preacher, and he was in his study at home preparing for his service, and that phrase, he's alive, he's alive, he's alive, just kept sort of rumbling around in his mind, and then he began to say it quietly and then a little bit more loudly, and then he got up from his seat and he began to pace around in his office saying, he's alive, he's alive. And he said before he knew what was even happening, the truth of our Lord's life, his resurrection, really grabbed him like it had never grabbed hold of him before. And he said, I gained a fresh, brand new realization that Christ is indeed alive. And it changed him. It changed his ministry. Well, a few weeks after Easter, Peter and John were on their way to the temple when they met a crippled man by the gate called Beautiful. He asked them for some money. But you know how preachers are. Preachers are notorious for not carrying money. That's all I'm going to say. I'm going to leave it right there. Peter responds with these now famous words, silver or gold I don't have, but what I have I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk. And the man stood up completely healed, and he began walking and leaping and praising God. The Bible says a crowd gathered around Peter, and he began to preach the gospel to them, challenging them to repent of their sins and turn to Jesus Christ for salvation. Now, when the rulers of the Jews heard about this, they had Peter and John arrested and held them overnight. Hit the pause button and make sure you just heard what I said. When the religious leaders, the religious rulers of Israel, heard what was going on, they had Peter and John arrested and held overnight. Acts 4:2 tells us that the rulers, the religious rulers, were disturbed because the apostles were proclaiming in Jesus' name the resurrection of the dead. Now, no doubt, some of this refers in part to the fact that the Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection at all. But they were incensed that Jesus' followers were making the claim that Christ had indeed risen from the dead. That kind of dangerous, heretical teaching could not and would not be ignored. They were going to deal with this thing and nip it in the bud. See, the truth is that some people have always hated Easter, and they've hated the Easter message because it challenges their belief system. I mean, the very idea that somebody could come back from the dead flies in the face of their self-professed knowledge of the universe. Doesn't make sense. Well, the next day, Peter and John were brought before the Sanhedrin, which is sort of like the Supreme Court of ancient Israel. And this group of 70 men had under Roman ultimate authority, they had the power to enforce Jewish law. They had the power to try cases. They had the authority to settle disputes. And so they asked Peter and John a question, and man, it's a wonderful question. And it's a great moment for the early church. Here's the question: by what power or what name did you do this? It's time for Peter to fish or cut bait. By what power or by what name did you do this? Now Peter's coming off sort of a bad time. You know, I watched the movie Son of God last night and enjoyed it tremendously. There's always a scene that grabs a hold of my heart. It's when Jesus announces that he's in fact going to die, that he's going to be arrested, and some bad things are coming down, and they're coming down quick. And Peter makes this declaration: I'll never leave you. I'll lay down my life for you. You can count on me, Lord. And you know what Jesus does. He turns to him and he says, before this night's over, you're going to deny me three times. And by the way, Peter denied the Lord on three different occasions on that evening when our Lord was arrested. So now, Peter's being asked, by what power, by what name did you do this? What will he do? Well, he's got at least three choices. He can apologize for making trouble, and there's no way that he's going to do that. He can say nothing and hope for the best, but Peter never said nothing in his whole life. He can seize the moment, and he can preach the gospel. Bingo, that's exactly what Peter does. He seizes the moment, and he preaches the gospel. Maybe he remembered the words of our Lord in Matthew chapter 10, beginning with verse 18, where Jesus says, on my account, you'll be brought before governors and kings as witnesses to them, and even before Gentiles. When they arrest you, don't worry about what you're going to say or how you'll say it. At that time, you'll be given what to say. He certainly wasn't going to back down. I mean, after all, he's got the entire leadership of Israel right in front of him. I mean, money can't buy that kind of audience. It was like having the president, his cabinet, Congress, and the Supreme Court sitting at your feet waiting for you to speak. No. To these men who think he's a dangerous troublemaker, Peter stands up and he preaches Jesus. No compromise, no hesitation, no apologies of any kind. And what he says doesn't really take very long at all. In five verses in Acts chapter 4, Peter lays out the gospel. You may want to open your Bibles to Acts chapter 4 because we're going to look at some amazing verses. Acts chapter 4, verse 8 through verse 12. And in this brief paragraph, we learn exactly who Jesus Christ is. First of all, this passage tells us that Jesus Christ is the stone the builders rejected. See, Peter answers the basic question, who did this, in verse 10. Well, the answer is simple. It's straightforward. Jesus did this. Jesus is responsible for this healing that has taken place on this day. Now, he could have stopped there, but we're talking about Peter, so he didn't do that. He continues his answer in verse 11, knowing that he may never have another opportunity like this again. He seizes the moment. Now, I want you to listen carefully to Acts chapter 4, verse 10 and 11. Peter says, "It is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed." Verse 11, "He's the stone you builders rejected." That phrase builders means you religious leaders, which has become the chief cornerstone. We just sang about that a moment ago. See, in these two verses, Peter says four things to the Jewish religious leaders. One, he says, you crucified Jesus Christ. That's literally true. They crucified him. Second, he says, God raised him from the dead. True. Third, he tells them by the power of Christ, this lame man was healed. True. And then he says, you rejected God's cornerstone for salvation. Again, true. Now, verse 11 in Acts chapter 4 is actually a quotation from Psalm 118, verse 22. And Psalm 118, verse 22 speaks of a rejected stone becoming the capstone or the cornerstone. Jesus himself used the same scripture when he gave the parable of the landowner just a few days before his crucifixion in Matthew chapter 21. Now, the image comes from ancient stone quarries where highly trained stonemasons carefully chose the stones that would be used in a construction project. No stone was more important than the cornerstone because the integrity of the entire structure depended on the cornerstone containing exactly the right lines. If the cornerstone wasn't exactly right, the entire building would be out of line. It'd be out of plumb. And for that reason, the builders inspected many, many stones, rejecting each one until they finally located the one they needed, the one they wanted. What happened to the rejected stones? They might be used in other parts of the building, but they would never become the cornerstone, and they would never become the capstone. That is the first and last stones put in place. Peter's saying that Jesus is the rejected stone whom God made to be the cornerstone of salvation. See, the Jewish leaders rejected him. But God not only accepted him, the Bible says, and I was pleased to read it this morning, God placed him, God put him in the position of highest authority and honor. He is seated at the right hand of God. Now here's the kicker. These men who should have known better did not recognize Jesus Christ for who he was. In fact, they made a massive mistake which became an eternal catastrophe. To reject Jesus means you've rejected God's cornerstone. Since the cornerstone's the foundation, anything you build upon the wrong foundation is itself wrong. I want to be very clear about what I'm about to say. And if you don't hear me say anything else this morning, please hear this. It is not enough to say Jesus was a good man. It is not enough to say Jesus was a good teacher, a fine teacher. It is not enough to say he was a great religious leader, but not the Son of God. If he's not who he said he was, then nothing he said can be trusted. Someone said, if Jesus is not who he said he was, then he should be treated as a man who was completely insane, untrustworthy. But thank God, he is exactly who he said he was. The Messiah, God's Son, God robed in flesh, come to earth to be one of us, ultimately to go to the cross after living a perfect, sinless life, going to the cross, dying a substitutionary death on our behalf. Christ was crucified, not for his sin, but for ours. Christ is the cornerstone of our salvation. But I want you to note that not only is Christ the rejected stone, he's also the living stone. Look at verse 10. Peter says in verse 10, "You crucified him, but God raised him from the dead." You crucified him. You killed him. But the word "but" in Scripture is always wonderful. But God raised him from the dead. Amen? Hey, if we couldn't say that this morning, we shouldn't even be here. But thank God, even though he was crucified, the Bible says, "But God raised him from the dead." It's through the name of Christ that a crippled man had become healed. It happened because Christ came back to life. It happened because Jesus rose from the dead. He's the living stone of eternal salvation. Now, I don't think Peter ever forgot that moment when he stood in front of all those rulers of Israel. I think it must have made a huge impression on him, because years later, when he wrote his little epistle of 1 Peter, he describes Jesus as the living stone, rejected by men but chosen by God and precious to him. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 4. And in that verse, we have two images joined together: Jesus the stone and Jesus the source of life. Jesus the stone, but Jesus also the source of life. Now, when those two come together, what do you get? A living stone. And again, I want you to be really taking note of something very important this morning. A dead Jesus can't save anyone. I've actually heard people say, it doesn't matter if Christ came back from the dead or not. It's what you think about it. It's how you let that death impact you. May I say to you that that is religious nonsense. A dead Jesus can't save anyone, but an alive Christ can absolutely change your life. Amen? Christ can change your life. Hebrews 2, verse 14 and 15 says that Christ came to free those who were enslaved to the devil through the fear of death. On Friday, it looked like the devil had won, but on Sunday, Jesus won the only battle that ever mattered. Amen? That's right. All day Friday, I couldn't help myself. I don't care what I was doing. I was busy Friday. All I could keep thinking was, it's Friday, but Sunday's coming. It's Friday, but Sunday's coming. I heard that sermon so many years ago, and it has never left my mind. And all I could think of all day long, no matter where I was, what I was doing, it's Friday. But devil, Sunday's coming. See, on Friday, it seemed like Satan had actually won. Oh, but on Sunday, Jesus won the battle that mattered. The resurrection tells us how it's going to end for the child of God. You know, there's an old gospel song. I think it may have been by the Cathedrals. That may not resonate with many young people, and some folks here understand who that group is. But I think they had a song with a line in it that went like this: "I've read the end of the book and we win." The book meaning the Bible. I've read the end of the book and we win. And you know what? It's true. We win in the end. Listen, knowing the ending helps us deal with what comes in between. Have you ever noticed that? Ever tape a ball game? And maybe, you know, you're just trying to avoid people who watched it in live time. Don't tell me. I'm going to go home. Don't tell me. But somebody inevitably goes, "Man," and they tell you who won. You go, oh. But with that same knowledge, you go into that game and you're watching this tape ball game, and your team may be behind. They may be getting pulverized, but some joker already told you they won. So it doesn't matter what they do or what's happening. You know, in the back of your mind, they're going to win. Okay, so what? I'll give that to them. They're going to win. Knowing the ending helps us deal with all the stuff that comes in the in-between. See, Easter teaches us that when the battle of the ages finally comes to the end, the home team wins. See, your future and my future may not be that pleasant. Truth is, your future may have some stuff in it that you would never want to welcome. Your future may include some losses and some tragedies and some difficulties that you can't even begin to imagine this morning, but I'm telling you something. Knowing how everything ends helps us deal with all the junk that comes in the in-between. Amen? See, we'll overcome all that stuff through faith in Jesus Christ, that one we know has risen from the dead. That's what it means to call Jesus the living stone. Knowing he's alive gives us courage to face our own death. Knowing that he's alive gives us the ability to cope with the death of people we've loved and lost. Knowing Christ has died but come back to life gives us the courage to face life when life slams you against the wall. Knowing Christ is alive changes everything. It's a game changer. So Christ, the rejected stone, became the living stone who is now, praise God, the cornerstone of our salvation. Some translations of the Bible translate Acts 4:1, and they use the word capstone instead of cornerstone as a possible translation. And that's okay, because the Greek word can be translated both ways. It can be translated cornerstone or capstone. Both are perfectly true when you apply them to Jesus. You know why? Jesus is the cornerstone, the first stone laid, and that determines the placement of every other stone. The capstone always came last and was placed at the top of an arch, thus holding every other stone in perfect alignment. Listen, God in his wisdom has made Jesus the cornerstone and the capstone of salvation. Everything begins and ends with Jesus. He's the Alpha and he's the Omega. If you miss Jesus, you've missed everything that God has for you. Christ is the one and only. Now let's get to the end of Peter's brief message. In verse 12, here he is standing before this religious group of men, 70 leaders. And he says in verse 12, salvation's found in no one else. For there's no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. Wow. Wow. There's no other name under heaven given to men by which we, say this word with me, by which we must be saved. That sounds so strange in today's world. Go out there and preach that in most urban centers, that Jesus is the only way to salvation, that Jesus is the only way to God, that there's no other path, no other road, no other way, and people will look at you and say, you're crazy. Why, we've even got Protestant preachers who have left the Bible and are now saying, you know what? I was wrong. I've come to realize that our world has become so sophisticated that there are many roads that lead to God. One religion would never be enough. But Peter didn't think that way. Peter says, under the authority and inspiration of the Holy Spirit, salvation can't be found anywhere else. There's only one name, and it's the name of Jesus by which we must be saved. You say, did Peter really mean that? Absolutely. See, that verse means that you can't cry out to anyone else and have any hope for salvation. Did you hear me? Not Buddha, not Confucius, not Krishna, not Muhammad. Not anyone else but Jesus. Here, the gospel is this. Jesus is the one and only. It's Christ and him alone. He's the only Savior that God has provided for salvation, and you must put faith in him or you will not escape the terror of hell. That is it, pure and simple. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and nobody but nobody comes to God except through me. Jesus is very exclusive. Five implications from that verse. Number one, you cannot reject Jesus Christ and have any hope for heaven. You cannot look to any other religious leader for salvation. You cannot combine Jesus with anyone or anything. You are not free to make up your own religion. And finally, you can't save yourself. In short, without Jesus, you're in trouble. You must come to God on His terms, not yours. See, again, the words of Christ are utterly exclusive, and they mean exactly what they say. There's no middle ground when it comes to Jesus. Let me take you back a few years. I had the opportunity to travel to India, to the southern state of Kerala, and I spent a week with some graduating seniors at the Solid Rock Seminary, and I also had the opportunity to preach an open-air revival in India. It was a really wonderful time in my life. Now, the crowd each evening was mostly Hindus, because that's the predominant religion of India. And the people were actually very fascinated by Jesus. They were very responsive when I spoke about Jesus in general terms. They would nod and smile, and they were really into it. But when I began to speak about the Lord's resurrection, the mood of the place changed. See, Hindus believe basically that all roads lead to God. If Jesus was my guru, they're good with that because they've got their gurus. And if I honor their gurus, everybody's one big happy family. But when I began to speak of the reason for my faith, that is the resurrection of Christ, all the nods and smiles would stop, and they would lean in and listen a lot more intently. The fact of the resurrection demands a response. The resurrection, the truth of the resurrection, reduces all other religions to mere philosophies. Let me say it a little differently, maybe a little bit more what may appear harsh. The truth of the resurrection reduces all other religions to false religions. Many of you that know me at all know that I don't have a sense of direction. I can get lost really easy. So years ago, I got a Garmin for birthday or Father's Day, and I loved it. I mean, I just had a love relationship with that Garmin. I'd plug that rascal in, and I felt like I was king of the world. I mean, I could go anywhere, get any place, never get lost. And then, of course, that's been replaced by your iPhone and Google Maps and all that stuff. And these days, man, somebody says, you know how to get where I live? I just go, absolutely. You give me your address, I know where you live. What I don't tell them is, I'm plugging that in. I am looking to turn right, turn left, go straight. Now, occasionally, it will take you on a wild goose chase. But for the most part, it gets you where you need to go. May I say to you that any other religious leader is a false compass. You may be on a religious road that may have you practicing religious deeds and reading quote-unquote holy books and doing holy things. Again, in quotes, but I'm telling you that if it is divorced from the gospel of Jesus Christ, it is a bad map. It is taking you down the wrong road, and you will spin your wheels, and you'll be forever running the race and never winning. You'll be forever traveling, 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 and never arriving where you hope you'll get, heaven. See, as long as Jesus is dead, then he's just another religious leader who lived and died, revered by his crazy followers. But if Jesus really rose from the dead, and I believe he did, then he stands alone. And nobody, and I mean nobody, can be compared to him. He is the one and only. Let me give you the Easter message reduced to a very small phrase. Jesus was rejected. Jesus rose from the dead. God made Jesus the cornerstone of our salvation. The time has come for you to choose. Choose you this day whom you will serve. The resurrection always demands a response. It demands that you either say, I believe or I don't believe. I receive or I reject. I embrace or I run in the opposite direction. So let me ask you some questions this morning. Who is Jesus to you? You know, Clyde, it was interesting when you said you had a conversation with a guy and you asked him, what does Easter mean to you? Basically, he said, I can drop my kids off and get about 2 hours of maybe peace and quiet at the home with none of those little children running around my feet asking for this or doing something that required any type of discipline. All Easter meant for this guy was an opportunity to chill on a Sunday morning for a couple hours. That's sad. But there's a world of people just like him. Who is Jesus to you? Not what is Easter to you. Who is Jesus to you? Is he the rejected stone or the cornerstone? Second question I'd like to ask is, whose side are you on? With those who crucified him or with those who follow him? See, God makes no deals when it comes to heaven. You either enter by way of the cross or you don't enter at all. It's sometimes said that the road to hell is paved with good intentions. By the same token, the road to heaven is paved by the blood of Jesus Christ. Which road are you traveling this morning? I started this morning by saying that not everyone shares our Easter joy, and they don't. What about you? What about you? May I just encourage you on this Easter morning? Don't be like the builders who rejected God's stone of salvation. Don't reject Christ. Don't stumble over the rejected stone. The very stone the builders rejected has become, by the glory of God, by the grace of God, by the sovereign plan of God, the stone they rejected has become, by God's own design, the cornerstone, the foundation of our wonderful salvation. Amen. I pray this morning what I've been praying all week long. May God open your eyes to see Jesus as he really is, the cornerstone of our eternal salvation. He is, my friends, the one and only. Christ himself said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one." How exclusive can you get? "And no one comes to the Father except through me." What does Jesus mean to you this morning? When he came, he entered this world robed in flesh. The glory of God, the God of the universe, the God of eternity, came robed in flesh, lived a perfect, sinless life. Went to Calvary, went to the cross, not for a crime he'd committed, but he went to pay our sin debt, for the wages of sin is death. That's the penalty. Christ said, "I came to seek and save that which is lost." He came from the very beginning to be our substitute. The blood of bulls and goats were only a picture, only a type in the Old Testament that would one day become reality in Jesus Christ. Yes, God hates sin, and God will reveal his wrath against sinners and sin. And I'm telling you today that unless Jesus Christ had left heaven, come to earth, lived a sinless life, died on the cross, a death that was substitutionary in nature, you and I would be hopeless this morning. But because he came, and because he died, and because he lives, we too can live. Amen? That's the hope of Easter. 42 years ago, I went to my first Easter service. I won't tell you what I look like. I bought a brand new suit, a new Easter outfit. Man, I don't know where that thing wound up. I hope it got burned. Collars down to here, a tie this wide, shoes this tall. I'm telling you, it was a mess. I walked in that church service that day as a believer, and with deep appreciation, for the first time in my life, I realized something. That Easter, listen, and I'm not downing all the ways we celebrate Easter, but Easter divorced from the resurrection of Jesus Christ is no Easter at all. Today, Christ, the rejected stone, the living stone, watch this, the cornerstone, he says to each one of us, "I love you. I came for you. I died for you, and I rose from the dead so that you might be able to repent of your sin and confess your faith in me, that I am indeed," as Peter said, "Jesus Christ is the Son of God, the Messiah, the one that God sent, and salvation is found only in him. This morning, we heard it mentioned earlier, Romans 10:13, but everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be, say it with me, saved. Not maybe, but everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you'll just say, Lord, what you say about me is accurate. I'm a sinner. And today, by your grace, I confess that. I agree with you. If I agree that what you say about me is accurate, I'm a sinner. Lord, I want to turn from that lifestyle. I want to repent. And I want to turn to embrace the good news. I want to have a relationship with your Son, Jesus Christ. And ultimately, I want to know you as Abba, Father, Daddy. If you're here this morning and you've never truly entered into a relationship with Christ, don't leave without doing that. Christ is the only way to secure a relationship with God. It won't happen through works. It's always and only by faith, faith alone in Christ alone. Amen? Turn to Jesus. Look to Christ and live. He loves you. He came. He lived. He died. He rose. And you can trust him this morning. If you'll give him your life, he'll give you salvation. Maybe you're here this morning, you're already a believer, but you've been drifting. You've been floating around, doing your own thing, not really living an obedient life. Listen, the Bible says that we're called to live differently. I read a quote by a preacher, it's been about 3 or 4 weeks ago. He said, if you want to see people redeemed, then maybe you need to start living like a redeemed person. Listen, your best testimony is not what you say, it's how you live. It's how you live. Why not say to Jesus this morning, because you live, because I have complete confidence in you, I'm coming back to the heart of the matter. I'm going to fall fresh in love with you. If you need a church, we'd love to embrace you. Step forward and say, I need a church home. We'd love to tell you how that can happen. Please stand. Please bow your heads. Stephen's going to come. The staff's going to join me. We would love to pray with you, pray for you. We'd love to minister to you. Maybe you came this morning and you've got an aching need in your heart. You came this morning and your heart's broken over something going on in your life, your family, and you just need somebody to wrap their arms around you and pray with you and pray for you. Wow, it'd be our delight to love you in Jesus' name by ministering to you in prayer. So as Stephen begins to sing with your heads bowed and eyes closed, pray with me. Father, in Jesus' name, may you be honored today for who you are. You are the rejected stone, the living stone, the cornerstone. Jesus, you're the one and only. Help us today, this Easter morning, to realize with fresh conviction that because you live, oh God, we can be saved, we can live the victorious life, and we can hope that in the end we'll be with you in heaven for all of eternity. Help us this day to make our stand with you. Help us this day not to reject you, but to believe on you, embrace you, and fall in love with you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Hey, I know there's a lot of us here this morning, but if God is speaking to your heart right now, we would love the opportunity to minister to you. Maybe you're a student, and during D-Now, you made some kind of significant commitment to Jesus. Come and share that before your church family. We would love to pray with you. You come as Stephen leads us right now.